Do you have several books just sitting on your shelf waiting to be read? Or maybe you've already started them, but you haven't finished them? This video is for you.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to my YouTube channel. My name is Olivia, and I have something to admit. I'm a mood reader. I don't always like admitting that because when you think of a mood reader, 9 times out of 10, there's probably several half-read books on their shelf. And nobody wants to be the book girly who reads a book, starts it, and then gets so distracted by something else she can't finish what she was currently reading. I don't think anybody wants to admit that, but in this video, I'm gonna hold myself accountable and I'm gonna admit that. I'm a mood reader. I have several books that I have started and not finished because I read sometimes, majority of the time, kind of all the time based on how I feel. And I thought it would be great to challenge myself to attempt to read all of my partially read books, hopefully to be able to finish a majority of them. And if you are also someone who's a mood reader, why you possibly clicked on this video and you're like, hey, this girl has a problem and I also have that problem, maybe this could be a great challenge for you as well to grab some of those books that you've started but not finished to hopefully read over the next 7 days to complete them just like I will be doing. And yeah, so without further ado, let's jump straight into today's video.
So the first book I decided to read is Coming Home to Stars Fall. I am literally almost done with this. I do really like it. I think it's giving me all the fall vibes, and honestly, I think it's gonna end pretty well, so I recommend it.
I am having myself some lunch. I made myself a little chai tea. Let me show you. Don't spill it. A little cinnamon and cream. Oh yeah, it's really, really good. And then I'm having some lunch and your girl has a lot of laundry to do. I feel ashamed at the amount of laundry, but actually no. I feel like a lot of people have trouble with their laundry. It's all clean. You can best believe your girl washes. Now folding and putting it away. Okay, well, I am gonna fold this laundry, eat my lunch, and then I'm gonna continue the audiobooks I'm listening to. So I've been listening to The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn and Harry Potter. I've been saving Divine Rivals only because I really like it. And I like to tandem read that with my book and like take my time and soak it in. Love it so, so much. So I'm not gonna listen to that one, but I'm gonna quickly get this done because then I have to meet with my sisters because we have a friend that's coming from Switzerland to stay with us for an entire week to just take her around Michigan, show her all of the sights. And so I want to fold my laundry prior to my guest and my sister staying at my house, but also because it needs to get done. But if I can finish this in a timely manner, I will potentially be able to do a little reading before I go pick up my sisters to kind of get some stuff ready here at the house.
Alrighty, so on the docket for laundry folding and lunch, I am listening to Harry Potter book number 4. I cannot remember the name of it for the life of me, but obviously there'll be a picture up on the screen. I really like it. I definitely can say it's my favorite book so far in the series, which I've liked all of them. This is my first time reading it too as an adult also, so I think it gives me definitely a different perspective, but I really do like it. That is definitely gonna be my favorite book so far in the series. I feel like it just made it seem so vast that there are other schools and like other things happening, not just Hogwarts, and so I really liked that. It really was very immersive for me and I really got hooked, and so very glad to say that I'm continuing this book. But yes, we are going to get this laundry folded and dive into the next part of the vlog. Okay, so the part of the book that I'm reading right now is like chapter 21, 22 of The Poppy War by R.F. Kuang. You guys, it gets crazy. When I tell you it's giving horror, oh my gosh, It was written beautifully, though. Like, she's a fantastic writer. I cannot wait to continue this series. Oh my gosh, like, this was just insane. This book was very, very good. I was very glad to have picked it up when I did. But yeah, it's just like she writes in a way that makes you feel like you're there. And I absolutely love that.
All right, so the lighting is horrendous, but there's not much I can do about it. It's late, and currently with like the time change and all the things, and the fact that it's winter almost, it's just dark. But I want to do a little update on this mood reading vlog. My apartment has been changed around, and if you can see, we decorated for Christmas. I just couldn't wait. But before this, you probably already know that because I put up a little book haul. So I have some books here that I will eventually be hauling for you guys, which you'll probably see before this ends up going up anyways. But I am still reading, still doing the thing. It has been some days since I like started working on this video. I had a guest in town, but we do have the Christmas stuff up November 1st. I was just so ambitious. I feel like when you have a difficult time and you're having a really hard season of life or whatever it is, you had a bad day, decorating for Christmas early doesn't really matter. You can do whatever you want. You can leave your Christmas stuff all year round. You can do whatever you want. But I feel like for me, I needed this and I'm glad I did it. And it's just helped so very, very much. I have all my Bath and Body Works candles. I'm currently burning one of my favorite Christmassy candles, which is vanilla balsam. I have to make sure that this comes back in stock this year because that is one of my favorite candles, literal the goat, as well as what does that say? Vanilla Bean Noel, and then the Christmas candle. I don't care who you are, where you're at, and what your favorite scent is. You need this in your life because it is the legit smell of Christmas. And it is called The Perfect Christmas. I have two of these. I'm going to restock on them when they have their sale and whatnot at Bath & Body Works. But I also have that that I'll burn eventually. But yeah, I just wanted to do a little update. I am still reading. I am 90% through The Poppy War. I'm thinking I'll finish that today. I am 50-something percent now in Talking at Night with Claire Daverly, which with that book, I feel conflicted. When I read it, I'll put some footage of me reading it soon. I'm gonna do some updates live with it to kind of give you my like thoughts more specifically than this little update. But I just feel a little bit like, not that it's getting drug out, but is the cycle that's happening going to continually repeat itself until we get to like the end when they fall in love? Or they're like together? Are they even going to be together? I don't know. So I'm feeling kind of conflicted with that. But nonetheless, I like it. And then I'm thinking I also want to get, Kill For Me, Kill For You by Steve Cavanaugh. I kind of want to get that done soon too. I think I'm at like 70% in that book. I don't know what it was about that thriller that I just kind of, I liked it, but I just put it down. So I think I want to get that done sooner than later.
Okay, so here's a little Christmas tour, I guess you could say. I'm just going to show you what I've done and what I've decorated. Still need a tree skirt. I need to get that. I will eventually. And I still don't have curtains. I'm not sure if I want to commit quite yet. But yeah, just changed up the setup of the living room. If you remember from my previous apartment, those old videos and how I had it set up, it is the exact same, but different obviously because of the size of the apartment. But yeah, I have this little, if it would focus, little croissant, little candle here I got from Target. I love croissants, like pastries, it's just my vibe. But yeah, you know, just some Christmassy vibes here, you know, all the things, but yeah. I've been sitting here for a little bit reading some more of the Poppy War, and I feel bad. I feel like most of the footage I've gotten has been of me reading this book, but please bear with me. We're going to talk some more about some other things in a moment. But I have this theory. So Rin went to synagogue and she met several different students there, and one of them being Nazah, who was like her rival enemy. She also met Alta in there, who is now like her commander in chief. She met a couple other girls she wasn't really close with, but then there was Kata. I believe that's how you pronounce his name. They were very close. I mean, he was like well off and whatnot and had a very influential family, but like he took a liking to her. They were kind to one another in school and everything. They talked a lot. And when the war began, they kind of lost touch and she kind of went her own way. He went on his assignment, and now they've kind of found each other again when they see like kind of just how the war is just caused destruction to everything, the land, the people, the different areas around, and they located each other again. Well, basically she found him because he was in a city that was just attacked and really just desolate, and he was located kind of in like a bunker hiding place. And at that time she was kind of deciding on whether or not she was going to follow Alton, her commander-in-chief, to do this thing that he thought was best, but was really dangerous and reckless. And I had thought she was going to act similar to Jude, where she was going to pretend to agree with it, but she had an idea up her sleeve to kind of like contradict him to do what she knows is best. But that's not really what she did, okay? Instead, prior to her going, she had mentioned to Kata about this and like what they were going to do, and to kind of like prepare him to get people to safety when they make this decision, because it's going to cause maybe some more destruction, and that he thought it was a really bad idea and was super against it. That was that. Then they went on their journey. They went to the location Alton decided. They went in to do their thing, and an issue kind of happened. And then all of a sudden, the people who were attacking them, the Federation, randomly show up at this location that they were at, which no one knew but freaking Kata and a couple of like their people and their like in Ren and Alton's group. That's it. So who the heck tipped off the Federation and now has captured Ren and Alton and brought them to this horrible place where the scientists are like dissecting them to figure out why they have this ability to call down the gods from the Pantheon? I'm thinking Kata is in on this. It just doesn't make any sense. Like there's no reason for them to have known this. You know, like, no, unless, yeah, there's no reason. So for me, this just feels very much like, I don't know, conniving and like, who tipped them off? Like, who did this? But yeah, that's basically how I feel. So I'm going to keep reading this and I'll either check up in back in with you when I finish it, or I'm on to a different book. So it has been a little bit of a minute since I've did an update for the mood reader vlog, this vlog right here. So I'm reading so many things. You guys know me. I think I've mentioned this several times over the last couple of years of having this YouTube channel, that I like to read many books at the same time. Being a mood reader, I think I even mentioned it in the intro of this video. That's why I do that. I think I love a lot of different things. I'm interested in a lot of different things, but after something kind of gets to a point where it's like, I need a break, whether it's getting too intense, it's getting a little boring, a little sus, then I'm gonna put it down and grab something else. And so I usually have a good chunk of books not finished. And that's why we're doing this vlog. So regardless, I want to do an update on the Poppy War. I'm on page 516, 96%, meaning I have 4% left, and I'm gonna be done with this book. And then I'm gonna dive into Kill for Me, Kill for You by Steve Cavanaugh. I think I'm 67% in that book right now. But oh my goodness, when I tell you this book, I feel like should almost have the like genre category of horror, because it has a lot of horrific parts, especially I would say chapter 21 and on. They just get really dark. And although I'm not someone who reads horror, and I think I only have like one maybe like two or three books that are actually categorized as horror. I think I have a Stephen King,
I have a James Patterson and then Lee Child, the one right there. I think that's horror, if I'm not mistaken, or it's just thriller. So it's not a genre I tend to go to, but I love psych thrillers. I just love just the twists, the turns, the whodunit. That is like my favorite. And so with this book, being that it's a YA fantasy, I think, unless it's adult, it's really intense. And those parts are kind of, I don't know, they're heavy. And I think when you think of like the casualties of war, or for example, like the Holocaust or the Rape of Nanking or like Pearl Harbor, or I believe in Haiti, there was also, I don't remember the name of it, but I remember there was like a genocide in Haiti, and then just like World War II and other things that happened besides just with the Jews. And so it's like, there's so many times, even just like slavery, there's so much of where horrible things happen when really bad people are in power. And I think from a distance and from a glance, most of us weren't raised in that time. And so we read a lot of it in history books or learn about it in school or whatnot, or at museums and different things. And so you kind of get a gist of maybe what it could have been like. Maybe you go to a museum that's focused on a specific time frame, and so you get maybe some pictures and different things. But like, you don't really get it from a history book as much as you would like if you were talking to someone. But the way that R.F. Kuang writes these parts of just how the Federation is attacking the people of Nakan, and just how that is, and how descriptive she is about just what they did to these poor people, and when they raided these cities, and just like how horrific, like, I don't know, like, just to think that this stuff, it seems, it's so bad. It's like, is this how the people during the is this how the Jews were during the Holocaust? Like, is this how it was? Like, did they treat them like that? You know what I mean? And it's like, 9 times out of 10, they did. And I think when you read it, it really just kind of opens your eyes of just how horrible war and conflict really is, and how like pursuing peace at all costs should be like your first priority. And so, I don't know. I think it's written excellently though. And it's not that those parts are like horrible and don't read them. I think she writes so good to where you're just like, you feel chills of reading it. Like, wow, someone could be that like dehumanized. Like, all the human, all the good can be gone, and they can do something like that. I think it's just kind of insane, but also like, she just did it so beautifully, which seems really like counterintuitive, or just like a little back contradictory. It's like, how could that be beautiful? But it's the way she wrote it. Like, wow. It really puts you in there to think like, that's what happens when people fight, you know? And so, I don't know, but I'm just kind of like, wow, this is crazy. I am definitely much into it. I know this is gonna be a 5-star read. I'm gonna keep reading and let you know my thoughts when I get done. And then at the end of the video, I will bring back with like my star rating and all of that at the very end.
I'm gonna be so honest with you guys. The Kindle changed the game. It changed my life. You need to get one. It is unbelievable.
We're back. A little update. Obviously, I got carried away reading my books. And I finished The Poppy War. 5 stars, obviously. Literally loved it. Cannot recommend it enough. It ended perfectly. I cannot wait for book 2. I've already downloaded it on my Kindle for next year. Then I dived right into Kill For Me, Kill For You by Steve Cavanaugh. And I've been so carried away, I forgot to do any updating here on the video. But I'm currently on page, which I'm trying not to look. I made my Kindle take off the percent and the page number, because I find when a book gets really exciting, your eyes can get racy. And then after you look and you've realized maybe you've only gone up a percent, but you've read like 20 pages or whatever, you can get kind of like annoyed. And so I take it off and just leave the time at the top. And then that way I read kind of not distracted. You know what I mean? Because maybe I'm zoomed in more, so it takes 4 swipes to finish a whole page, like in a book or whatever. But you guys, I have cracked it. I know what happened. I know who did it. And obviously, I think I'm at like 70-something%. Obviously, I don't know what like the final twist is, but I know what's happening. And I really just want to like spill the beans, but I want you to read it. I haven't read a thriller in a minute, have I? I don't know. It just brings back all the reasons why this is one of my favorite genres, because you're reading, you're like, wait, this is crazy. So basically this book, just to give you a gist of what's happening without telling anything, basically this book, we have these two women who meet out of a support group because one woman lost her daughter through like a kidnapping kind of murder situation, and then her husband ended up taking his life because of it. Then another woman who her daughter and husband were murdered, or her husband died and then her daughter was attacked or something like that. They meet in a support group. And they're grieving women. They've all gone through like all the different phases of grief, you know, the denial, the sadness, the anger, you know, the revenge, everything. And they start talking, and one of the women is really keen on like, I think we should do this little pact. You kill for me, I kill for you. The other lady isn't as convinced, but she's kind of going along with it because maybe this is what needs to happen. She needs to get this revenge. Well, somewhere else in the city, it's happening in New York. There is a woman who has been attacked in her home by a horrible man and has gotten away with it. And she's just traumatized. Her husband wasn't home at the time. And so now they've like left their home. She can't live there anymore. She just can't stand it. And he's kind of just taken her to different hotels and just trying to protect her. Well, she apparently feels like she could possibly see that man somewhere. And her and her husband kind of go on this little journey together with figuring out how to handle her situation. And then you see how these three women intertwine and things start going crazy. People are lying. It's insane. And it's just like, wow. And I'm at the point now where the code has been cracked. We know what is happening. Like, we're fully aware of who did it. You know what I mean? I almost feel like I should be holding the physical book. Hold on a second. Add to the vibes here. So let me hold the physical book as I talk. And then I'm shaking the camera. But OMG. OMG. You guys. It's good when you get to that point of the thriller. You're like, wait. Hold up. No, they didn't. You're responsible for this. You the crazy one. And you're just like, it's good. It's good. I'm definitely reading the Kindle version though, because I feel like I can go a lot faster with that. But I am just obsessed. I'm loving this. I'm hoping I can finish it tonight. And then I think I'm gonna dive into Yours Truly and try to get that done. Or I have Talking at Night. Both of them I think are like 55% done. So very quick reads. We'll see. Talking at Night is fun to read at night. I find like I can get a lot of that done at night just because the vibe of the book is like talking at night, basically. Okay, so I'm in the process of doing my nails. Hold on one second. What is happening? Yeah, I'm in the process of doing my nails right now. And so I've been listening to the audiobook of Divine Rivals. So I'm now like catching up my Kindle to where I'm at. I'm at chapter 28. Oh my gosh, I'm about to start part 3. I'm at page 200, it looks like. Yes. Oh gosh, and now all of these things are happening and the emotions are high. I am, yes, doing my nails, like I said, but chapter 28, lots of progress. 55% done the book. There's so much more. So part 3 is basically half of the book, it looks like. Is that says part 3? Oh, wow, there's way more in part 3. What am I talking about? There's 42 chapters plus the epilogue. I'm at chapter 28. So, okay, we're not doing too bad. Not doing too bad. But yeah, chapter 28, finally, as you can see, a divine rival. And this is Romans chapter. And so it says, Dear Iris. But I don't think I'm going to continue more of it. I think I want to dive into something a little bit happy. Not that Divine Rivals isn't happy, but a little less in the feels, if you know, you know. So I think I want to dive into Harry Potter and continue that audiobook right now while I finish up my nails. So I'm glad that I have everything updated. So I'm going to get out of this. And then when I get done, I'm going to finish Kill for Me, Kill for You. Thank you. all of my books are just wrecking me. I don't know. And I can't wait till these are finished so that they can be read and we can move on to something maybe a little bit more fluffy. Because at this point, I feel utterly wrecked. But it is the next day. Maybe I'll put some little like time stamps or something on this video. I'm not sure. This is a project. I'm so proud of myself for doing this, but man, is it a project. So where am I at in terms of updates of reading? Harry Potter, I'm 79% into the audiobook. I decided to listen to that whole series basically through Audible, as well as like the Percy Jackson series when I was reading it. I feel like the narrators of both of those are just really good. And so I'm listening to that, 79% into it now. I decided to continue Talking at Night here on my Kindle by Claire Daverly. And I'm currently 68% in that. I think I'm on page 266. Yeah, 266. How do I feel? This book is like, I don't know. It's just like crushing my heart in so many ways because it's like, I don't know what's gonna happen. Like, it's supposed to be a romance or, but not maybe in the way that I expected it. And so, yeah. And so I feel like my heart is just kind of being like, oh, no, no. And it just kind of keeps doing that. And so, who knows, but it's like kind of stressful. I can definitely say one of the main characters, Rosie, she gets on my nerves. I don't really like her as a character. I think the way that she's written, I think the way Claire writes all of her characters, but definitely how the way she's written, how she wrote Rosie is so spot on to a person who suffers with overthinking, scattered thoughts, you know, those type of things, even like compulsions of different types, like the way that she writes that, even like the people pleasing, all of it, like she's hit the nail on the head so perfectly that it's almost like you can definitely see yourself. I can see myself at least in a lot of the things that she does, but I think that's why I'm not the biggest fan of her, because you can say like hindsight's 20/20, like you're looking at someone, you know, doing things that you do, but you're not currently doing them. And so, and then you look at her, you're like, girl, it's not that hard. Just figure it out. But then when you're in the middle of it, you can't see it. And so I think that's why I'm like, have conflicting feelings with her. But I think it's still a good book. I definitely think it's going to be a higher rated book if I feel like it can get to a point where like it is coming to an end. It definitely feels like it's going on this roller coaster kind of where you don't really know what the end is supposed to be.
Right.
I finished it. OMG. When I tell you, this is a fantastic thriller. Now, I've read some great thrillers in my day. You know, I have a few that I can like, these, they were bomb. Sorry about the squeaking chair. But there's something about, like, I read, what was the book called I read? Coast to Coast Murders by James Patterson. I can't remember what I rated that. Maybe like a 3 or something star. My biggest thing with a thriller, psych thrillers, you know, is that it's okay if I figure out 50%+ who did it or what twist or get some idea. At least as like I'm getting through the book and it's like, okay, I'm starting to find out that because the way these characters are acting, the way things seem, maybe this could be the route, or I have a couple ideas. That's totally fine. That's the point. That's the fun, you know? But what gets me is like, you do that, you figure it out, and then that's it. Then when the author kind of tells you it, you're just like, I already knew that. And then the book kind of just ends, or the ending is rushed. And they have no way to like make a satisfying ending. You guys, I want to beat this over your head. Read this book. When I tell you, okay, first off, okay, I got to the point where I was like, I know what's happening. But still I was like, but could it be? Okay, so it is. But then you think, is it going to die? It kept picking up and picking up. Then a whole nother thing came. Second twist thrown in the mix. And you're just like, wait, there's no way. Then you get to like 1.5 chapters done and the twist comes out again. Then you get to the end and a third twist and you're like, this book had me literally on the edge of my seat for basically like all of it. I'd say probably like the last 60% of the book, I was just like, no way, no way, no way. This was so good. Alrighty, good morning. I have my little coffee here. My little, this is massive. It's like the size of my hand. It's like a cinnamon, obviously like an espresso pod. I just use the espresso ones and I've been into this one. I don't know if it's gonna focus too good. Yeah, that one right there. And they're just like the smallest size you can get. It's delicious. I've went through 50 already. And so, or maybe not 50, but like almost 50. And so I bought another set on Amazon. Really love that. Not using a Christmas mug today, but that's okay. I wanted kind of some protein shake in my coffee today. And so I needed it to be a little bit bigger. So this is what I'm using. But I made some bagels yesterday. I found a really, really good bagel recipe. And I'm toasting one up this morning. Like, I'm gonna go give it to family and friends. Like, I'm just like really happy. I think it's gonna be one of my favorite ones because it's a quick recipe. Because usually the bagels that I make take all day because they're sourdough, so they ferment. But this is a sourdough recipe that I'm able to make the same day. And I think it took like in total 3.5 hours. And so I think that's fantastic. So they're kind of like quick ready-made bagels and they look fantastic. But yeah, I am going to, actually, I'll show you them. Because I have some that I'm going to give away to some friends that I have sealed tight in a baggie. But we have the plain. We have a cinnamon brown sugar kind of sugar one. Then we have a cheese one that has this really good seasoning from Trader Joe's. It's called spicy, garlicky spicy or whatever. It's in a little thing. It has like pieces of garlic and parsley and red pepper flakes and some nice sea salt. Like, it is the best seasoning. I use it on everything. And then we just have a regular plain cheese. So I just put cheese on top and then this one with the seasoning just in case like their little does not want something spicy. But I did that. I'm gonna have one for breakfast, enjoy my coffee. But I have to update you. Oh my gosh, you guys. Okay, so I finished 2 books last night. Actually, I finished 3 books yesterday. You saw the update of Kill For Me, Kill For You. Loved it, OMG. Then I picked up Yours Truly and I was at 50% or 47 and I finished it. You guys, I cried. I cried so hard. I mean, tears rolling down my face. My heart was shattered. I was completely undone. I loved it. But let me tell you, the back and forth, fake dating. Does he love me? But he doesn't. But I love him. But he probably doesn't love me. But I do love her. But she doesn't love me. I hate that. I ain't gonna never read another book like that again. I don't know if that's the fake dating trope or whatever that is. But that irked my living soul so badly to where I was gonna DNF. Like, I was at the point of like, this is so annoying. And then I also don't like when romance books, they like fall in love and then there's like something that comes between them and they're like, psych, I can't do this. And then they come back and I can't do this. I don't like that. Love each other and stay together. You know what I mean? That's just where I'm at. But oh my gosh, I cried tears. So deep and so heavy. Like, I'm gonna post some pictures here, here, and here of some of my favorite quotes on the screen so that you can see them because you guys, my heart, I don't know. It was just like, so many emotions I felt while reading it. Like, that was a really good book. I think the way Jacob was written, the male main character, was amazing. I love that she kind of showcased anxiety, like of how that really can be for somebody. And I felt so seen in so many of those ways. And I just loved how Brianna was able to be somebody for him, to help him in those situations when he was feeling extremely anxious. And like, just to think if you could have someone who could do that for you with whatever you're going through, like, I just think that was so beautiful. I love the way that she wrote just everything, even the grief that Brianna went through, just all of it, I think was fantastic. And like, loved that book. Then I was in the middle of making bagels at like 11 o'clock at night. And so then I ended up staying up and I ended up finishing Harry Potter book number 4. And tell me why chapter 33, I bawled my eyes out. If you know, you know. My first time ever reading this series, guys, so bear with me, but I cried my literal eyes out. Chapter 33, chapter 34, and like sniffled through until chapter 37 at the end of the book. Like, when I tell you, just cried, and just Harry, and what he was able to see, and Cedric, just everything. It was just so many emotions. And just like, I have this feeling like, is Sirius Snape, like, is he good? I don't know. Like, does my heart kind of go out to him now? I don't know. Just so many things. Dumbledore is the GOAT. Like, I don't even know. I just, yeah. Cried my eyes out, y'all. I'm not even gonna lie. Like, maybe I was emotional from yours truly, but I'm not sure. But like, that book got me. Honestly, my favorite in the series so far. But yeah, I'm on a roll, guys. Like, I'm feel really proud of myself. So far with this video, I have finished Coming Home to Stars Fall, The Poppy War, Kill for Me, Kill for You, yours truly, Harry Potter. Is that it? And I will catch you guys a little bit later. Alrighty, hello everyone. I'm here to end off the vlog and talk to you about what I was able to read. I am quite under the weather, or progressively becoming more under the weather as the days go on. Like yesterday, I felt like dirt, sore throat, my ear, and then last night was like brutal. Couldn't really breathe, and like the cough and the voice change, all of that is developed today. So we'll see how tomorrow goes. I was feeling like I might get a fever. It's just all of the things. It's not great. It's just really not great. But I do have a large thing of tea here. But this is the mood reader vlog. I am really proud of myself. I did a lot. I read a whole bunch of books and I got finished with some other books, and I'll talk to you about the ones that I either don't plan on finishing right now or what was my reasoning behind maybe not getting them done, so on and so forth. And so I want to talk to you about that. I am really excited. I definitely feel like this was a good challenge to kind of do, because I'm a mood reader by trade, and so I really love reading multiple books at a time. And usually that's because maybe I get tired of one book, or it's getting too intense, or it's boring and I want to switch to something else just for some variety. But usually I may not finish that book. I'll find something else, because I have a wide range of books I read. I'm not really like the cliche kind of the average bookish girl in her era of reading. Like, I read almost anything, but not usually the trendy stuff. Like, I'm starting to kind of find books that are more trendier and popular that I want to read, but I'm usually someone who reads books that maybe people haven't really heard of or aren't as popular, things like that. And so I'm really proud of like seeing myself progress over these couple of years on YouTube and with reading, and see myself be able to actually read books that I had started and not finished. And so I want to talk to you about those and give you my thoughts and everything. Let me grab my iPad, because then I can get on my Goodreads. Hold on. Let's open this up, because everything is tracked on here. So I'll be able to let you know. So I can't remember with the beginning of the video what books I had talked to you about wanting to read, but I had several of them that I didn't have finished. And I had two books that I never even got back into. One of them being Us by David Nichols, and the other being The Noise by James Patterson. So those are books that I had that were not finished that I just decided not to get back into right now, and those were my reasonings. But to go into the very first book that I finished for this video, which was Coming Home to Stars Fall by Kate Hewitt. And that is a little cozy fall romance, small town, grumpy sunshine. And it was really cute. I ended up giving that 3 stars. I just felt like the grumpy wasn't grumpy enough for me. I feel like he could have been written a little bit more grumpy. I definitely feel like he kind of fell out of his grumpiness too fast and almost fell in love so quickly, to the point where it felt very unnatural and very strange that he was in love so quickly. His name was Joshua and her name is Lori. Prior to that, which was not included in anything I talked about, I'm not sure if I did, was Remarkably Bright Creatures by Shelby Van Plett. I ended up listening to that through Audible with one of my favorite narrators, Myrin Ireland. I ended up giving that 5 stars. It was so good. I was on the fence with it for a long time, just because I didn't know if I would get into it, but because my favorite narrator was narrating, or one of my favorite narrators, I had to. And I can't recommend it enough. It's like literary fiction, I believe. Let me click on it and see, tell you specifically. But I love the book so much. Like, it Yeah, literary fiction. It has animals. There was a, like a, I wouldn't say a talking, but in a way like a talking octopus who could at least understand humans, but humans didn't know he could really understand them till like towards the end. Magical realism, mystery. It was just really, really good. And I loved it so very much. I can definitely say that it will pull on your heartstrings and it will make you just see the beauty and what animals can bring to your life. Like, it made me think of like my cat or our family cat, Fluffy. He's just so special. And I think if you're not a pet person, it might be hard to realize it, but when you become someone who like loves an animal and what they can do for you and they're yours and you've been through so much with them, it's like the love you have for them is so intense. I can't imagine what it's like to be a parent. You know what I mean? Like, so I just loved how the author was able to intertwine just like this beautiful sea creature and this older main character and just how it like worked and just how beautifully she wrote it, and then all of the other characters that she put in that just made the story blossom and bloom. I really, really love that. And then the next book that I ended up getting into and completing was The Poppy War by R.F. Kuang, book number one in the Poppy War series, and I've already downloaded book number two on my Kindle. I just need to get the physical copy because I partially tabbed before I got the Kindle copy, and so I need to add the rest of my annotations in, and so I need a physical book. I need to. This I loved. I gave it 5 stars. Honestly, cannot recommend it enough. What did I put as my review? Let me go in and check, really see if there's anything significant that I want to like touch base on. But yeah, this was by far I think my second favorite read of the year. I loved it so much. What I can say is I've never read about like any Chinese or Asian culture that much. I think I have one other book on my, yeah, the something library. I can't, the Library of Legends, I think is the only other one I think I own that is remotely about any form of Asian culture at all. And, or Chinese culture. I don't think I have anything else. Oh, Cinder. I have Cinder. And then, yeah, I think that's it. That's like all I have. But with this, I was a little bit hesitant just because it's like, would I get into it? Would it be something that would grab my attention? But basically, the way she writes is so amazing. I mean, she drags you in so deeply with just loving the characters of how she's written them, even the side characters that you maybe don't see very long in the book. But then you like, okay, you have the characters that you're loving, but then she writes the war in such a beautiful way, which seems so contradictory because it's war, but her writing is so, she's so talented that like, you're invested in what's going on. Like, you're trying to figure out what's happening with the Federation, what's going on with these people, who's doing what, and how do we stop it? Like, I was so engrossed in just the war and what was happening. I think that's what really helped, the world building and all of that. Like, not only did I love the characters, but I loved the story, and I was so fascinated with that. And I think that's what helped me just fall in love with it. I think it was really lovely paced. I did a little bit of audio listening to it as well. I recommended the narrator was very nice, but then I decided just to read it flat out on my own. One of my favorite quotes that I have was on page 478, and it said, "Rin had been tortured, bound, beaten, and starved, but her mind was her own. Her god was her own, and she would die before she betrayed it." And I just really love that because I feel like at the beginning of the book, we watched Rin on this journey of not really knowing what to do, who she really was, where does she fit in, and then at the end of the book, we saw such character development of her coming to a point where it's like she knew who she was, she knew what she was meant to do, and here we go. And so I just absolutely love that. 5 star, cannot recommend this enough. The next book I ended up finishing was Kill for Me, Kill for You by Steve Cavanaugh. And this was just really, really good. I started this a while ago now, but again, it was one of those books that I just kind of loved and put down and picked it back up. This was so good. The twists and the turns were unbelievable. I ended up giving this 5 stars. It's really interesting with me with thrillers because sometimes you can read them and you can figure it out kind of early on, which is fine, but then it matters. Then it shows how good the author is if then after you figure it out, they're able to write the end of the book so good that you don't feel like it fell flat, like you already know what's happening. And this I think was amazing. This is a book that I honestly think I would reread. Which is kind of crazy. There's not many thrillers I think on my shelf that I think I would reread. Maybe The Silent Patient and The Woman in the Library. This might be another one that I think I would reread and find more in it that I didn't see from the beginning. I'm really glad that I ended up finishing it. And then I ended up finishing Yours Truly by Abby Jimenez. This is my first book by her. And I have given it 5 stars. But that was, did I give it 5 stars? I did. I gave it 5 stars. But one thing I can definitely say is I debated not doing that. Only because there was a chunk of the book when they figured out how they felt about each other. But this constant pulling of, but I don't, but you do, but I don't, but you do, but I do love you, but I don't love you, but maybe he doesn't, but maybe she doesn't. I mean, that for me, that kind of whatever that is that characters go through before they like officially realize it. And then again, they're back again at that issue of like, but I just can't, but you can, but I can't. I hate that. I despise it. It gives me so much anxiety and I just would prefer that to not happen. And I feel like it went on for so long through the book. I even felt at some points tempted to just scan the pages quickly to get to more dialogue instead of all their internal thoughts, because to me it was so annoying because they felt the same way. So that was just deeply frustrating for me. But once I got through that chunk of the book that was like that, well, I feel like the beginning of the book I just absolutely loved. It was like a small chunk in the middle where that was happening. But the ending and the beginning, the book was amazing. I cried a big crocodile tears. I mean, I sobbed like a literal baby. These quotes in this book literally just took me out. I think I have 2 in my review that I'm gonna read to you guys. And one of the quotes that I really love, it says, "We are all a little broken, Brianna. We are a mosaic. We are made up of all those we've met and all the things we've been through. There are parts of us that are colorful and dark and jagged and beautiful. And I love every piece of you, even the ones you wished didn't exist." And then it says, "We texted I love you to each other from across the ER at work, left it in little notes, whispered it into the dark, and said it right in the middle of conversation just because we could. My life was a fairy tale. I didn't take 1 second with her for granted. I swore to myself I never would be able to hold her while we watched a movie, or come up behind her to hug her while she drank her coffee, or put a hand in her thigh under the table. It was all a gift, a privilege, and I vowed to always honor that. I wrote about it in my journal when I had time to journal. I was too busy living the dream that was my life to sit down and document it. But I was so happy." And then the last quote I have says, This is what it feels like to be truly loved. I've never felt it before, and I didn't realize it until now. He smiled at me gently and said, yes, this is what it feels like." Are you crying? Because I'm crying. Or maybe I'm not. Maybe you're crying and it just looks like I am. But OMG. There's so many more quotes, and I highlighted that book. I think all of it's highlighted. Like, literally, that's how I felt. Besides some few chapters in the middle that were just sending me, and I was just so irritated, the rest of the book was so good. Book, and then to dive into the next book I ended up finishing, was Harry Potter book number 4, The Goblet of Fire. This is by far my favorite book in the series. Oh my God, this is my first time reading it. I loved it. It's just everything. First of all, I figured out that there are more schools than Hogwarts. I had no clue about any of that. So I think that was really nice, how expansive that the author made it all seem now. Then at the end, Harry Potter had that encounter with 2 people that he just loved and everything, and it was just so good. And then I cried at the end, like chapter 34 through 37, just bawled my eyes out, like feeling so many emotions. I just loved it. I love just the friendship that Ron and Hermione and Harry have, and how they just care about each other. I just really love that. I love how special it is, and how they're just like there for each other, even though they have issues and disagreements. Like, they are true best friends, and I just love that so much. I've already downloaded the audiobook to book number 5, so I'm excited to dive into that soon. But yeah, I don't think I have book 5 book, and so I need to get them, because for so far I have like the first 4. So I need to get the last 3, I think it's 7 books, I think, or 8, I'm not sure. Divine Rivals by Rebecca Ross. I ended up getting to page 200, yeah, which is chapter 28, and I really loved it. I am tandem reading this, audiobook, physical copy, and Kindle copy. I really do like it. I think this is gonna end up being a very high rated book for me, but for whatever reason, reading this is just so intense for me. Could just be my personality. And so I find that I, like do it in chunks and then come back to it. And so I didn't end up finishing it, but I got a lot further in the book. I think I ended up picking this book back up around like page maybe 100. So I mean, I feel like I've read a lot in it so far. And so I'm very proud of myself for getting more of it finished, but not completely done. I think I'm at the halfway mark. then I have another book that I got more deeper into. I think I'm now at 67% in it, and that is Talking at Night by Claire Daverly. This book is really good for someone who likes chick lit, literary fiction, romance, but the characters are becoming so unlikable, especially like the main character, Rosie. She's just really unlikable now. And it's just kind of like so much to the point where like she gets on my nerves as a character. And lastly, we have Mistborn by Brandon Sanderson. This book here, did I pick it back up? I think I'm at 31% in the book. And so I read a very small amount in it. It's a pretty thick book, you know, not too bad. And then the font is really tiny and it's like a lot on the page. This is very good. I think he's a fantastic fantasy writer. I was completely engrossed in it, but I think this is a book that I need to dedicate time to just like sit down and just like solo read and let this be like the only thing I'm kind of going through, just because I feel like there's just a lot to take in. There's so much that he's doing and how vast it is, and I really love it. I believe it'll be a 5-star for me, but it just wasn't something that I just wanted to really pick up as I was reading this. So there's only been about 3 books that I didn't get through, but I finished more in them. And so I'm really proud of myself. I'm really glad I was able to do this challenge. Let me know down below if you decided to pick up any of your books while you watch this. It's probably gonna be a very long vlog just because of all the things and how long it took me to film it. But if you watch to the end, I am so, so thankful for that. Don't forget to give the video a thumbs up and subscribe and like and share all of the bookish things. But yeah, let me know if you finished any books down below. What are some books you still have not read or partially read that you really want to get done? Let me know those as well. And yeah, without further ado, I'll catch you guys all in my very next video. Bye.